Chapter 6, Globalization and Social Change. No discussion on social change in the 21st century can take place without some reference to globalization. It is but natural that in this book on social change and development, the terms globalization and liberalization have already appeared in your earlier chapters. Recall the section on globalization, liberalization, and rural society in chapter 4. Go back and read the section on Indian government's policy of liberalization and its impact on Indian industries in chapter 5. It also came up when we discussed Vision Mumbai and new visions for global cities in chapter 3. Other than your school books, you must have come across the term globalization in newspapers, television programs, or even in everyday conversation. Activity 1 will help you notice various ways the term is used. But we still need to clear about what exactly that the term means. In this chapter, we seek to understand the meaning of globalization, its different dimensions, and their social consequences. However, this does not mean that there can be only one definition of globalization and only one way of understanding it. Indeed, you will find that different subjects or academic disciplines may focus on different aspects of globalization. Economics may be dealing more with the economic dimensions, such as capital flows. Political science may focus on the changing role of governments. However, the very process of globalization is so far-reaching, the disciplines have to increasingly borrow from each other to understand both the causes and consequences of globalization. Let us see how sociology seeks to understand globalization. You'll recall our earlier discussions on the scope of sociology and distinctive character of the sociological perspective. We go back a bit in order to focus on the significance of the sociological perspective to understand globalization. You read the above paragraph carefully, you will realize that since sociology is not defined by what it studies or but how it studies, it would not be quite right to state that sociology only studies the social or cultural consequences of globalization. What it does is use the sociological imagination to make sense of the connections between the individual and society, the micro and macro, local and global. How is the peasant affected in a remote village? How is she or he connected to global changes? How has it affected the chances of she or he being employment for the middle class? How has it affected the possibilities of big Indian corporations becoming transnational corporations? What does it mean to the neighborhood grocer if the retail sector is opened up to big transnational companies? Why are there so many shopping malls in our cities and towns today? How has it changed the way young people spend their leisure time? There are a few just examples and wide-ranging and different kind of changes that globalization is bringing about. You'll find many more instances whereby global developments are affecting the lives of people and thereby affecting the way sociology has to study society. With the opening up of market and removal of restrictions to the import of many products, we have many more products from different corners of the world in our neighborhood shops. Since April 1, 2001, all types of quantitative restrictions on imports were withdrawn. It is no surprise now to find a Chinese pear, an Australian apple vying for attention in a local fruit stall. The neighborhood store also has Australian orange juice and ready-to-fry chips in the frozen packets. What we eat and drink at home with our family and friends slowly changes. The same set of policy changes affects consumers and producers differently. What may mean greater choices for the urban, affluent customer may mean a crisis of livelihood for a farmer. These changes are personal because they affect individuals' lives and lifestyles. They are obviously also linked to public policies adopted by the government and its agreement with the World Trade Organization,
Likewise, macro policy changes have meant that instead of one television channel, we have literally scores today. Dramatic changes in the media are perhaps the most visible effect of globalization. We'll be discussing this in greater detail in next chapter. These are just few random examples, but they may help you to appreciate the close interconnection that exists between your personal lives and the apparently remote policies of globalization. As mentioned earlier, the sociological imagination enables to make this connection between the micro and the macro, between the personal and the public. Sociology has been often defined as the discipline that studies society. You would remember from your discussion in book 1, class 11th, that the boundaries of society are not easy to draw. A study of a village not only meant study of different social groups and their societies, but would also have to take into account the ways the village society was linked to the outside world. This linkage is more valid today than ever before. The sociologist or social anthropologist cannot study society as though it was an isolated entity. The compression of space and time has changed this. Sociologists have to study villages, families, movements, child learning practices, work and leisure, bureaucratic organization or caste. Taking this global interconnection into account, studies will have to take into account the impact of WTO rules on agriculture and therefore on the farmer. The effect of globalization is far-reaching. It affects us all but affects us differently. Thus, while for some it may mean new opportunities, for others the loss of livelihood. Women silk spinners and twisters of Bihar lost their jobs once the Chinese and Korean silk yarn entered the market. Weavers and consumers prefer this yarn as it is somewhat cheaper and has a shine. Similar displacements have come with the entry of large fishing vessels into Indian waters. The vessels take away the fish that used to be earlier collected by Indian fishing vessels. The livelihood of women fish sorters, dryers, vendors and net makers thereby get affected. In Gujarat, women cum collectors who were picking from the Juli Fera lost their employment due to the import of cheaper gum from Sudan. In almost all cities of India, the rag pickers lost some of their employment due to import of waste paper from developed countries. We'll see later in the chapter how traditional entertainers are affected. It is obvious that globalization is of great social significance, but as you saw, its impact on different sections of society is very different. There are therefore sharply divided views about the impact of globalization regarding its effect. Some believe that it is necessary to herald a better world. Others fear that the impact of globalization on different sections of people is vastly different. They argue that while many in the more privileged section may benefit, the condition of a large section of already excluded population worsens. There are yet others who argue that globalization is not a new development at all. In the next two sections, we look at these issues. We find out a bit more about the kind of global interconnections that India had in the past. We also examine whether indeed globalization has some distinctive features, and if so, what is it? Are global interconnection new to the world and to India? If globalization is about interconnection, we can ask whether this is really a new phenomena. Was India or the different parts of the world not interacting with each other in earlier times? The early years, India was not isolated from the world even 2000 years ago. We have read in our history textbooks about the famous Silk Route, which centuries ago connected India to the great civilizations which existed in China, Persia, Egypt and Rome. We also know that throughout India's long past, People from different parts came here, sometimes as traders, sometimes as conquerors, sometimes as migrants, in search of new lands, and settled down here. In remote Indian villages, people recall a time when their ancestors lived elsewhere from where they came and settled down where they live now. Global interactions or even a global outlook are thus not novel developments unique to the modern period or unique to modern India. Colonialism and the global connection. We began our story of social and economic development in modern India from the colonial period. You'll recall from chapter 1 that modern capitalism had a global dimension from its very inception. Colonialism was part of the system that required new sources of capital, raw materials, energy, markets, and a global network that sustained it. Often globalization today identifies large-scale movement of people of migration as a defining feature. You know, however, that perhaps the greatest movement of people was the migration of European people who settled down in America and Australia. You'll remember how indentured laborers were taken away in ships from India to work in distant parts of Asia, Africa, and America, and the slave trade that carted thousands of Africans to distant shores. Independent India and the world. Independent India retained a global outlook. In many senses, this was inherited from the Indian nationalist movement. Commitment to liberation struggles throughout the world. Solidarity with people from different parts of the world was very much part of the vision. Many Indians traveled overseas for education and work. Migration was an ongoing process. Export and import of raw material, goods and technology was very much part of the development since independence. Foreign firms did not operate in India. So we need to ask ourselves whether the current process of change is radically different from anything we have seen in the past. Understanding globalization. We have seen that India had significant links with the global world from very early times. We are also aware that Western capitalism as it emerged in Europe was both built upon and maintained by global control over resources of other countries as in colonialism. The important question is, however, whether globalization is just about global interconnections or it is about some significant changes in the capitalist system of production and communication, organization of labor and capital, technological innovations and cultural experiences, ways of governance and social movements. These changes are significant even if some of the patterns were already evident in the early stages of capitalism. Some of the changes, such as those flowing from the communication revolution, have in a myriad ways transformed the way we work and live. We seek to spell out some of the distinctive features of globalization below. As you go through them, you will realize why a simple definition of global interconnection does not capture the intensity and complexity of globalization. Globalization refers to the interdependence between different people, regions, and countries in the world. As social and economic relationships come to stretch worldwide, although economic forces are an integral part of globalization, it would be wrong to suggest that they alone produce it. It has been driven forward above all by development of information and communication technologies that have intensified the speed and scope of interaction between people all over the world. Moreover, as we shall see, there was a political context within which it grew. Let us look at different dimensions of globalization. To facilitate our discussion, we deal with the economic, political and cultural aspects separately. However, you will soon realize how closely connected and interconnected they are. The different dimensions of globalization. The economic. In India, we often use the term liberalization and globalization. They are indeed related but are not the same. In India, we have seen how the state decided to bring some changes in its economic policy in 1991. These changes are termed as liberalization policies. The economic policy of liberalization. Globalization involves a stretching of social and economic relationships throughout the world. This stretching is pushed by certain economic policies. Very broadly, this process in India is termed as liberalization. The term liberalization refers to a range of policy decisions that India state took since 1991 to open up the Indian economy to world market. This marked a break with an earlier stated policy of the government to have a greater control over economy. The state after independence had put in place a large number of laws that ensured that the Indian market and Indian indigenous business were protected from competition of the wider world. The underlying assumptions of such a policy was that an erstwhile colonial country would be at a disadvantage in a free market situation. You have already read about the economic impact of colonialism in chapter 1. The state also believed that the market alone would not be able to look after all the welfare of the people, particularly its disadvantaged sections. It felt the state had an important role to play for the welfare of the people. You'll recall from chapter 3 how important the issues of social justice were for the makers of Indian constitution. Liberalization of the economy meant the steady removal of the rules that regulated Indian trade and finance regulations. These measures are also described as economic reforms. What are these reforms? Since July 1991, the Indian economy has witnessed a series of reforms in all major sectors of economy. The basic assumption was that greater integration into global market would be beneficial to Indian economy. The process of liberalization also involved taking of loans from international institutions such as International Monetary Fund. These loans are given on certain conditions. The government makes commitments to pursue certain kinds of economic measures that involve a policy of structural adjustments. These adjustments usually means cut in state expenditure on the social sector such as health, education and social security. This is also greater say by international institutions such as World Trade Organization. Among the many economic factors driving globalization, the role of transnational corporations is particularly important. TNCs are companies that produce goods or market services in more than one country. These may be relatively small firms with one or two factories outside the country in which they are based. They could be gigantic international one whose operation crisscross the globe. Some of the biggest TNCs are companies known all around the world: Coca-Cola, General Motors, Colgate, Palmolive, Kodak, Mitsubishi, and many others. They are oriented to the global markets and global profits, even if they have a clear national base. Some Indian corporations are also becoming transnational. We are, however, not sure at this point of time what this trend may mean to people of India as a whole. The electronic economy. The electronic economy is another factor that underpins economic globalization. Banks, corporations, fund managers, and individual investors are able to shift funds internationally with a click of a mouse. This new ability to move electronic money instantaneously carries it with great risk, however. In India, often this is discussed with reference to rising stock markets and also sudden dips because of foreign investors buying stocks, making a profit and selling them off. Such transactions can happen only because of the communication revolution. In contrast to previous eras, the global economy is no longer primarily agricultural or industrial in its basis. The wheatless economy is one of in which products have their base in information, as in the case with computer, software, media and entertainment products, and internet-based services. Knowledge economy is one in which much of the workforce is involved not in the physical production or distribution of material goods, but in their design, development, technology, marketing, sale and servicing. It can range from the neighborhood catering service to large organization involved in providing a host of services for both professional meets like conferences to family events like weddings. We have a host of new occupations that was unheard of a few decades ago. For instance, event managers. Have you heard of them? What do they do? Find about their such new service. Globalization of finance. It should be noted that for the first time, mainly due to information technology revolution, there has been a globalization of finance. Globally integrated financial markets undertake billions of dollars worth transaction within seconds in the electronic circuits. There is a 24-hour trading in capital and security markets. Cities such as New York, Tokyo and London are the key centers for financial trading. Within India, Mumbai is known as the financial capital of the country. Global communications. Important advances in technology and the world's telecommunications infrastructure has led to revolutionary changes in global communication. Some homes and many offices now have multiple links to the outside world, including homes and many offices, telephones, fax machines, digital television, electronic mail and the internet. Some of you may find such places, some of you may not. This is indicative of what is often termed as digital divide in our country. Despite this digital divide, this form of technology do facilitate the compression of time space. Two individuals located on opposite sides of the planet, in Bangalore and New York, not only can talk but also send documents and images to one another with the help of satellite technology. The process of globalization is giving rise to network and media society to create global interconnectedness more efficiently. The government of India has initiated an ambitious program in form of Digital India, in which every exchange will incorporate digitization. It will transform India into digitally empowered society and a knowledge economy. You have already seen how an outsourcing operates in your earlier chapters. Cellular telephony has also grown enormously, and cell phones are a part of the self of the most urban-based middle-class youth. There has been a tremendous growth in the usage of cell phones and a marked change in how it use is seen. The following marks that shift. Globalization and labor. Globalization and a new international division of labor. A new international division of labor has emerged, in which more and more routine manufacturing, production and employment is done in the third world societies. You have already dealt with outsourcing in chapter 4 and contract farming in chapter 5. Here we simply draw upon the example of Nike company to illustrate how it works. Nike grew enormously from its inception in the 1960s. Nike grew as an importer of shoes. The founder Phil Knight imported shoes from Japan and sold them at athletics meetings. The company grew to a multinational enterprise, a transnational corporation. Its headquarters are in Beaverton, just outside Portland, Oregon. Only two US factories ever made shoes for Nike. In the 1960s, they were made in Japan. As cost increased, production shifted to South Korea in mid-70s. Labor costs grew in South Korea, so in 1980s, production widened to Thailand and Indonesia. In 1990s, we in India produced Nike. However, if labor is cheaper elsewhere, production centers will move somewhere else. This entire process makes the laboring population very vulnerable and insecure. This flexibility of labor often works in favor of the producers. Instead of mass production of goods at a centralized location, we have moved to a system of flexible production at dispersed location. Globalization and employment. Another key issue regarding globalization and labor is the relationship between employment and globalization. Here too, we see the uneven impact of globalization. For the middle class youth from urban centers, globalization and IT revolution has opened up new career opportunities. Instead of routinely picking up BSc, BA, BCom degree from colleges, they are learning computer languages at computer institutes or taking up jobs at call centers or business process outsourcing companies. They are working as salesperson in shopping malls or picking up jobs at the various restaurants that have opened up. Globalization and political changes. In many ways, it was a major political change, namely the collapse of the erstwhile socialist world that hastened globalization and also gave a specific economic and political approach to the economic policies that underpin globalization. These changes are often termed as neoliberal economies measures. We have already seen that concrete steps of the liberalization policy took in India. Broadly, these policies reflect a political vision of free enterprise, which believes that a free reign of market forces will be both efficient and fair. It is therefore critical of both state regulation and state subsidies. The existing process of globalization in this sense does have a political vision as much as an economic vision. However, the possibilities that there can be a globalization which is different do exist. We thus have the concept of an inclusive globalization, that is one which includes all sections of society. Another significant political development which is accompanying globalization is the growth of international and regional mechanism for political collaboration. The European Union Association of Southeast Nations, South Asian Regional Conference, and more recently South Asian Federation of Trade Association are just of the examples that indicate greater role of regional associations. The other political dimension has been the rise of international government organizations and international non-governmental organizations. An intergovernmental organization is a body that is established by participating governments and given responsibility for regulating or overseeing a particular domain of activity is transnational in scope. The World Trade Organization, for instance, increasingly has a major say in the rules that govern trade practices. As the name suggests, INGOs differ from intergovernmental organizations in that they are not affiliated with government institutions. They are independent organizations which make policy decisions and address international issues. Some best known INGOs are Greenspace and Red Cross, Medicine Sans Frontiers. Globalization and culture. There are many ways that globalization affects culture. We saw earlier that over the ages, India has had an open approach to cultural influences and has been enriched because of this. The last decade has been seen major cultural changes leading to fears that our local cultures would be overtaken. We saw earlier that our cultural tradition has been wary of Kupamandukam, the frog that lives its whole life within a well, knowing nothing else and is suspicious of everything outside it. It talks to no one and argues with no one on anything. It merely harbors the deepest suspicion of the outside world. Fortunately for us, we retain our traditional open-ended attitude to this day. Thus, there are heated debates in our society, not just about political and economic issues, but also about changes in clothes, styles, music, films, languages, body language. You will recall from chapter 1 and 2 how 19th century reformers and early nationalists also debated on culture and tradition. The issues today are in some ways the same, in some ways different. What is perhaps different is the scale and intensity of change. Homogenization versus globalization of culture. A central contention is that all cultures will become similar, that is homogeneous. Others argue that there is an increasing tendency towards globalization and culture. Globalization refers to mixing of global with the local. It is not entirely spontaneous, nor it is entirely delinked from the commercial interest of globalization. It is a strategy often adopted by foreign firms while dealing with local traditions in order to enhance their marketability. In India, we find that all the foreign television channels like Star, MTV, Channel V, and Cartoon Network use Indian languages. Even McDonald's sells only vegetarian and chicken products in India and not its beef products, which are popular abroad. McDonald's does vegetarian during the Navratri festival. In the field of music, one can see the growth of Bhangra pop or indie pop, fusion music, and even remixes. We already seen how the strength of Indian culture has its open-ended approach. We also saw how, through the modern period, and reformers and nationalists actively debated tradition and culture. Culture cannot be seen as an unchanging fixed entity that can either collapse or remain the same when faced with social change. What is more likely even today is that globalization will lead to creation of just not new local traditions but global ones too. Gender and culture. We often defenders of a fixed traditional idea of cultural identity defend undemocratic and discriminating practices against women in the name of cultural identity. These could range from defense of sati to defense of women's exclusion from education and participation in public matters. Globalization can be taken as a bogey to defend unjust practices against women. Fortunately for us in India, we have been able to retain and develop a democratic tradition and culture that allows us to define culture in a more inclusive and democratic fashion. Culture of consumption. However, we speak of culture, we refer to dresses, music, dances, food. Culture, as we know, refers to our whole way of life. There are two ways of culture that any chapter on globalization should mention. They are the culture of consumption and corporate culture. Look at the crucial role that cultural consumption is playing in the process of globalization, especially in shaping of growth of cities. Till the 1970s, the manufacturing industries used to play a major role in the growth of cities. Presently, cultural consumption of shapes to a large extent the growth of cities. This is evident in the spurt in the growth of shopping malls, multiplex cinema halls, amusement parks and water world. In every major city in India, most significantly, advertisements and media in general promote a culture where spending is important. To be careful with money is no longer a virtue. Shopping is a pastime actively encouraged. Successive successes in fashion pageants like Miss Universe and Miss World have led to tremendous growth in industries in the fields of fashion, cosmetics and health. Young girls dream of being an Aishwarya Rai also with the scene. Popular game shows like Kaun Banega Crorepati actually made it seem possible that your fortunes could turn over a few games. Corporate culture is a branch of management theory that seeks to increase productivity and competitiveness through the creation of a unique organizational culture involving all members of a firm. A dynamic corporate culture involving company events, rituals, and traditions is thought to enhance employee loyalty and promote group solidarity. It also refers to way of doing things of promotion and packaging products. The spread of multinational companies and the opportunities opened up by the information technology revolution has created in the metropolitan cities in India, class of upwardly mobile professionals working in software firms, multinational banks, chartered accountancy firms, stock markets, travel, fashion, designing, entertainment, media, and other allied fields. These high-flying professionals have highly stressful work schedules, get exorbitant salaries, and are the main clientele of the booming consumer industry. Threat to many indigenous craft and literary traditions and knowledge systems. Yet another link between cultural forms and globalization is evident from the condition of many indigenous craft and literary traditions and knowledge systems. It is, however, important to remember that modern development, even prior to the stage of globalization, did make inroads into traditional cultural forms and occupation based on them. But the sheer scale and intensity of the change is enormous. For instance, about 30 theatre groups which were active around the textile mills around area of Paral and Gaum of Mundispecity have become defunct, as most of the mill workers are out of jobs in these areas. Some years back, there were reports of large number of suicides by traditional weavers in Sirsila village of Karimnagar district and in Dubakka village in Medak district, both in Andhra Pradesh. These weavers with no means to invest in technology were unable to adapt the changing consumer taste and competition from power looms. Similarly, various forms of traditional knowledge systems, especially in the fields of medicine and agriculture, have been preserved and passed on from one generation to another. Recent attempts by some multinational companies to patent the use of tulsi, haldi, rudraksh and basmati rice has highlighted the need of protecting the base of its indigenous knowledge systems. It is no easy task to sum up the diverse and complex ways that globalization is affecting our lives. One will not even attempt it. One leaves this task to you. We have not discussed the impact of globalization on industry and agriculture in any detail here. You have to draw from chapter 4 and 5 to build up the story of globalization and social change in India. In the recounting of this story, use your psychological imagination.